Grace and peace be with you. Hi, my name is Mark. I'm the pastor of Sycamore Creek Church in Potterville. Thank you for joining us for our online worship service as we continue in our series, God Is. As we get started today with worship, a reminder that we are moving content on our YouTube channel from our Sycamore Creek Potterville YouTube channel to our main Sycamore Creek Church, Michigan YouTube channel. If you have been enjoying these worship services, if you want to continue to connect and watch online worship services, you can do that through that Sycamore Creek Church, Michigan YouTube channel, where all of our content is going to be housed now. Particularly, this service will be in a Potterville worship playlist. As we start our worship service today, thinking about God Is, happy Mother's Day. Today is Mother's Day. We are so grateful for all of the moms in our lives and the impact that we have. And we also recognize that today can be a difficult day for lots of people. Not every mom is perfect. Not everyone has had a great experience with their mom. And there's some moms who are no longer with us. Today, as we approach that, we're going to talk about mothering. We're going to talk about God and then how God can be a mother to us. But let's start with this chat question. Well, what's one thing that you're grateful for about a woman, a mom in your life? What's one thing that you're grateful for? I think about my own mom. I think about her patience and her kindness. In particular, my mom is very careful with her words and how she talks about things. And I really appreciate that about her. I appreciate that in talking with me and with my brother, she's very careful to not show favorites or to advantage one son over the other. She uses her words with care and shows kindness to both of us in her love for us. How about for you? What's one thing that a mom, it doesn't need to be your mom, but just could be some other mom that in your life that you appreciate and are grateful for about them? We're going to continue our worship, and I invite you to join Kevin in this first song.
Mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone? Carried by your constant grace, held within your perfect peace. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Every step we are breathing in your grace. Evermore we'll be breathing out your praise. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful.
Today we're going to be talking about how God is mother and midwife. And as we prepare for that, we're going to become aware of God's presence with us as we worship. We have a worship practice that helps us to do that. I'm going to invite you to go and get a candle and to light that candle as an act of worship. Now, maybe you don't have a candle. Don't go turn on a light. Do something to remind you that God is present with you right now as you worship. I'm going to light my candle. I invite you to light your candle at home. May the light of that candle remind you of God's presence with us as we worship. Will you join me in prayer? God, we thank you today for Mother's Day. We thank you for what a gift life is, and that ultimately we would not have that gift of life without a mother. God, in the midst of heartache and hurt and hope and joy and gratitude and all the different things that we might feel from others, we look to you, God. We look to your perfect love for us. We look for the ways that you sacrifice for us, that you reach out for us, that you never give up on us. And we pray, God, that at our best, as we look to mothers today, we would look to you as the ultimate mother, the one who represents the best of what it means to be a mom, as a parent cares for their child. God, may we be wrapped in your embrace today as we worship, and to know that you are fiercely protective and loving of us. In the name of Jesus, we pray, and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to continue praying with me as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Please join me in that prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Today we have Pastor Mikkel with us from the South Lansing campus giving the message. Again, happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. Mikkel is going to be talking about God as mother and midwife. And today's message begins with this.
What do you think of when you imagine God? It's past time to expand the ways we think about God through personal story, theology, spirituality, and social justice. We will explore feminine metaphors and untapped language for God. Some familiar, some less well-known, but all revelatory of a God who is more than we've been allowed to imagine. One thing is for sure. God is more.
Who else knows that church on Mother's Day can be a little dicey? I don't know which is worse. I've shown up on Mother's Day to a message on Proverbs 31, on how we can do and be all the things to be a decent woman. Or when there's a testimony from the pastor's wife that's introduced as, well, she's just going to talk to the women now and us guys are just going to kind of listen in. And then I've seen the awkward displays of appreciation for moms, where all the moms stand up and then they figure out who's been a mom for the shortest amount of time and the longest amount of time. And those two women get some kind of prize. That's almost as bad as showing up to a church and they ask all the first-time guests to stand up and introduce themselves. It's well-meaning, but so, so awkward. So maybe you're bracing yourself this morning. Like, in what direction is this going to go? How much are they going to focus on moms and motherhood? Sheesh. Maybe you're a man here asking yourself the same question. Am I going to be able to relate to any of this? Is this going to be like a man bashing message? Well, we are going to talk about motherhood and becoming mothers, but in a way that you may not be expecting. We're going to talk about how God is mother and midwife. Really, we're going to be talking about how God is just as feminine as God is masculine. And while that idea is challenging for all kinds of reasons, it's really beautiful and I find it really exciting. We're in week two of our series, God Is, based on the book by Mallory Wyckoff. I met Wyckoff through the Post-Evangelical Collective and I really enjoyed the chances I've had to learn from her. We started this series last week, setting this stage with a conversation on how God is more than we've been led to believe. And next week, we'll talk about how God is mystery. In our fourth week, God is home. That one is going to be at Fenner Nature Center. And then we'll wrap up, God is wisdom within. For many of us, this series is stretching and is pushing us out of our comfort zones. These are new ideas that challenge us. For others, this series is incredibly healing and comforting. And I expect today to be no different. Claiming that God is just as feminine as God is masculine can cause some confusion because many of us have only ever heard and used masculine metaphors and pronouns for God. Besides, doesn't Jesus always call God Father? Well, yeah, but there are other images and ideas that we find in Scripture that describe the divine feminine. Now, before we go any further, let's pause here for a chance to reflect. Where do you resonate with the idea that God is just as feminine as God is masculine? And where do you sense resistance to that idea? Take a minute and talk about it or put it in the chat. Today we're exploring how God is a mother and midwife. And we're going to start with this idea that God is mother. Now, there can be a lot of reasons that we feel challenged by this image. Maybe this image is difficult because we had a difficult relationship with our mother. Maybe this image is difficult because you are a mom and you recognize your own shortcomings. Maybe this image is difficult because it's new. You've heard of God as Father, but you've never considered God as Mother. Maybe you're affected by the messages that we receive in our culture that consider women less than, and subconsciously, you don't consider Mother God strong enough or wise enough to be divine. Maybe this is challenging because of the ways you've been taught how to read the Bible. Maybe it's a combination of all of those things. I'm glad that this isn't an image that Wyckoff or I have invented on our own. And it's exciting to me to have the chance to explore these new ideas together. In the Old Testament book of Isaiah, God's people are anticipating imminent exile. The fall of their nation is on the horizon, and they are scared. And Jerusalem says, "The Lord has deserted us. The Lord has forgotten us." Now, as a prophet, sometimes Isaiah writes in God's voice. It's a little unclear how exactly this happens. Like if Isaiah hears something from God and then records it word for word, or if he's like possessed by God's spirit and doesn't know what he's writing, or if he uses a sort of prophetic imagination. But whatever the case, he writes a reply to Jerusalem in God's voice. Never can a mother forget her nursing child. Can she feel no love for the child she has born? But even if that were possible, I would not forget you. God is comparing herself to a mother, to a nursing mother. What a beautiful image. On one hand, this is a very sentimental message, just like mothers love their babies so much, and so too does God love us. Mothers love their babies so deeply they could never forget their children. But I want to take this a step further. And this is an image that only mothers who have nursed babies will truly understand. Like, we remember how it felt to go hours and hours without nursing our babies. Like, do you remember that? A whole group of people just had a very physical memory just now. Because when a nursing mother doesn't nurse, her breasts fill with milk. It becomes painful. It can cause clogged ducts and even mastitis. Milk leaks, soaking her shirt. You cannot forget your child. Your body will not let you. And so it is with God. So deep is God's connection to us. Later in Isaiah, this post-exile, the image of God as nursing mother continues, and here God is offering more comfort and softness, embodying a different aspect of motherhood. This is what the Lord says: "I will give Jerusalem a river of peace and prosperity. The wealth of the nations will flow to her. Her children will be nursed at her breasts, carried in her arms and held on her lap. I will comfort you there in Jerusalem as a mother comforts her child." I can remember when my kids were babies and they would sometimes just become really fussy. It's what babies do. They would cry and cry. And I would think, it's only been a little bit of time since they last ate. Surely they're not hungry yet. So I would start changing their diaper, walking around with them, seeing if they're sleepy, if I can get them to take a nap. And then in desperation, I would try feeding them. And who knows what it was about feeding them. Maybe it was the comfort of a full belly, the soothing of sucking, or just the closeness to me, but they would often find comfort in my arms. And God promised to be like a nursing mother to Israel, comforting those whiny, angsty, independent people like a mother offers comfort at her breast. For many, motherhood is a wide open invitation to embrace embodiment. In the early newborn days, there is a body that needs to be tended and a body that needs to do the tending. We love our children with our bodies, picking them up, carrying them around, feeding them, rocking them, changing their diapers. And then later, when they're toddlers, holding their hands, following them around to keep them out of the street and out of trouble, wrestling them. I watch my friends who have toddlers, and I remember how on I had to be all of the time just to keep my kids from dying. It was exhausting. Our backs ache from it, and our arms are sore. Carrying the baby in the car seat and the toddler on the hip, like, it was so intense. Parenting young children is a whole body experience. I remember when my kids were toddlers, and they liked to climb up behind me while I was sitting on the couch and then like wedge themselves between my shoulders and the back of the furniture. And sometimes that's just happened to be the time when I realized they needed a fresh diaper. Motherhood can be exhausting and difficult, but that's not the only thing motherhood is. There's so much joy in motherhood, in watching our children take their first steps, say their first words, reach new milestones. From beginning to read to learning how to drive, we watch our hearts walk around outside our bodies, and we feel like we might burst. Mother God takes joy in us in that same way. Now, sometimes this idea of Mother God can be uncomfortable, because I know myself as a mother. I know that the pictures we take will show sweet and beautiful moments, but there are so many moments that weren't sweet. Moments where I lost my temper and I yelled at my kids, where I used the size of my body to intimidate them into submission, where I cried at having to get up one more time to feed my baby. And in these times, I think, oh God, I hope you're not like a mother. Because I'm a mother and I know what it feels like to absolutely lose myself in this, to be so done with this whole thing. Well, thankfully, in some ways, motherhood doesn't really allow us too much time for this kind of reflection, because even in the midst of my guilt or my sadness or my desperation, my kids still have needs. And so once again, I stoop down and draw those little ones into my arms. I prepare the next meal. I don't pretend to know all the emotion God feels, or if she gets frustrated with me, or if she thinks to herself, if I have to say this one more time. But I do know that God has loved me with God's body, and God has mothered us all along. God holds us with God's body and with tenderness and care and compassion. The Hebrew word for compassion, rachamim, comes from the root word rachem, which means womb. Like a mother, God held the people of Israel in her womb, nurturing them and holding compassion for them as her children. These images and ideas, they're not just from the Old Testament either. Jesus even embodied this kind of motherly compassion and love. In one poignant scene, he stood over the city of Jerusalem and he said, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often I have wanted to gather your children together as a hen protects her chicks beneath her wings, but you wouldn't let me." There's something that is so healing and encouraging to me in this. Like, I'm not on the outside. I, as a woman, I'm not an afterthought. I'm not a deformed man, as some early philosophers supposed. I'm not a second place substitute for the man who didn't show up to lead like he was supposed to. God is just as feminine as God is masculine. And so we remember mothers from the nursing room, the mothers holding the hand of their disabled adult child, mamas changing diapers and gently caring for tender flesh, who drive 4 hours one way to see a specialist, the mamas who cross deserts holding their infants so they can know a life without violence, who prepare gluten-free food for their food-sensitive toddler, who scrape together meals when resources are scant, who scrub floors and countertops so their families can have clean spaces. We remember mamas who labor in fields with babies strapped to their backs, mamas who cover their children's ears so they don't hear gunshots, mamas who prepare snacks for the whole soccer team, who gently bathe little ones when they haven't showered in days. We remember mamas who take care of their children even while they're grieving a miscarriage, mamas who fit in their cancer treatment before picking their kid up from middle school, mamas who fall to their knees praying for their child to get sober, mamas who attend class with their toddler in their lap, who braid hair and tell their babies how beautiful they are. We remember mamas who show up to yet another city council meeting demanding sufficient services for their child, moms who make birthday cakes to celebrate special days, who miss their children who died in middle age, mamas who pump in airport bathrooms so their babies can have milk, who stay up to make sure their teenagers get home safely, mamas who make a home out of a tent in a refugee camp. The world can be a dark and lonely place, yes, but there are mamas nurturing life everywhere. And from the beginning, God has always been a mother, extending her arms outward to embrace her children, soothing our aching hearts, binding our deepest wounds, and inviting us to a table with ample food and drink for all. So when we get overwhelmed by the darkness, the suffering, the oppression in the world, it can bring such hope to remember that Mother God is there, embracing us, soothing us, holding us in her lap with tender compassion. Let's stop here for another chat question. Where do you resonate with this image of Mother God? And where do you sense resistance? Take a minute and talk about it. So we started with talking about how God is mother, and now we're going to talk about God is midwife. There's something so strange about knowing that you're in the final weeks of pregnancy. They say if a baby is born after 37 weeks gestation, they're no longer considered premature, and women can go past their due dates to like 41 or 42 weeks gestation, depending on their doctor and specific medical concerns. That's like 5 weeks variation. Those last few weeks and months are generally very uncomfortable. Braxton Hicks contractions, which are only different from real contractions in that real contractions can lead to delivery, they can start like halfway through pregnancy. Your organs are totally rearranged to make space for a whole human. My babies were pretty average at like 7 or 8 pounds at birth. One of my good friends in Chicago had twins and they were like 6-ish pounds each. That is a lot of baby. That's a lot of something that isn't your own internal organs to be inside a person. Not to mention how carrying that kind of weight can look and feel very different depending on mom's size. Like a 7-pound baby sits different inside a 5-foot even woman compared to a 5'10 woman. I remember my hip and my back hurt so much by the end of my last pregnancy, it was difficult to walk. And through all of that discomfort, through all of the anticipation, generally speaking, women are just pretty much looking forward to more pain because labor is painful. And labor only gets more painful as you get closer to delivery. So where for so much of our lives, pain is an important indication to avoid something, like a burn tells you to avoid fire, scrapes and cuts remind you to be more careful on your bike, twinges in your back tell you to be more careful how you lift, especially as you get older. In childbirth, the pain you feel is not your body's way of telling you something's wrong. It's your body telling you that everything is right on track, that it's doing what it needs to do, that each contraction is purposeful and is leading you closer and closer to the moment where new life emerges. The pain of childbirth is purposeful. At their best, midwives are a non-anxious presence during this painful process. A midwife is a trained health professional who helps healthy women during labor, delivery, and after the birth of their babies. Midwives tend to spend more time with the laboring person, providing care and attention that other healthcare providers just can't provide. They don't have the time. So they don't rush the process. And this is vital because when a laboring woman is rushed, her body sometimes shuts down and then just halts the process. The body senses threat and responds. And when your body is assessing fight or flight modes, it doesn't have much energy to devote to working a baby through a birth canal. So midwives sit with women who are naked, vulnerable, writhing in pain, and totally exposed. And they whisper, "You're doing great, mama." There's no shame or judgment of the raw humanity. There's only the gift of full affirming presence. This is what midwives do, and it's why I image God as midwife. Like a midwife, God comes alongside of us in our most vulnerable experiences, where we had every intention of being composed and camera ready, but in reality, we're a naked mess, writhing on the floor, sweat burning our eyes, feeling like we can't endure another moment, and God whispers, "You're doing so good, mama." At the point we feel the weakest or the most vulnerable or the most afraid, God is most present, attentive to us, affirming us. Labor is a messy process in every possible way, but midwives, just like God, don't shy away. Midwives enter into the mess, never shaming women for their fear or their cries or their nakedness. And at the same time, midwives remind you that this pain will not kill you. It won't do you in and end you. Sensing pain doesn't always mean things have gone badly or that something is wrong. Sometimes it just means that you're a human, having a very human experience. This human is giving birth. Midwives remind you that the pain you're feeling has the power to bring forward new life, life you could never have dreamed up in a million years. Maybe at this point you've checked out a bit because you've never experienced childbirth and you never will. But that's not all that midwives do. Midwives also support a birthing mother's partner in knowing how to best support her. And even if you are not a birthing mother or have a spouse who births, I bet that you've experienced a painful transition in your life, a season where you just wanted to snap your fingers and skip to the next part. In Isaiah, God speaks of this promise. When you go through deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I bet there have been so many different seasons in your life that felt like deep waters, seasons that felt like the fire. When you wished for nothing more than to skip to the end, to move on to the next thing, to get out of whatever it is you were going through. And in those seasons, God midwives us. God reminds us that the pain is real, but will not overtake us, that we have all that we need within. And this movement was purposeful. This movement was taking us somewhere, and that ultimately new life was being born. Let's stop for one more chat question. Where do you resonate with this image of God as midwife? And where do you sense resistance? At best, Mother's Day in a worship service is a celebration. It's a joyful recognition of mothers and the ways they show up for their children. But for many, it's awkward. For many, it's deeply painful. For women who have experienced loss and longing, the loss of their mother, the loss of children, or the longing to be a mother, this day can be so, so painful. Now, I've been on your side of the message. Some years longing for recognition of all the sacrifices I was making to try to be a good mom. My husband Nathan and I grew up in homes that approached these days very differently. His family didn't feel a lot of need or pressure to celebrate these days, and so he didn't really see the point of it. It was like a made-up Hallmark holiday designed to drive consumerism. Now, in my family, we didn't always do a great job of celebrating these days, but we tried. And when my older two were toddlers, which means they had very high needs and constant attention, I remember telling Nathan that it would be so easy for our whole lives to just focus on our kids, and I just wanted one day to be recognized. I felt like I was losing myself in motherhood, and I just wanted to feel seen. And then there were some years on Mother's Day when I was in so much pain after our own losses. I felt gutted and empty. My arms ached from their emptiness. And the celebration of Mother's Day left me feeling unseen in a very different way, like there was no space for my grief or my pain. And then I've been on this side of the message, doing my best to recognize the day, holding space for all of the nuance and the pain and the joy of this day. And wherever you're at today, I pray that you feel seen. In your pain, in your joy, in your longing, even in your numbness. I pray that in whatever place you find yourself today, that Mother God would be like a midwife to you, completely unbothered by your very human mess, coaching you through the pain of transition and celebrating the new life that emerges. Let's pray together.
God of all creation, we come to you who mothers us, to grieve with, honor, and celebrate women in our midst.
As a mother comforts her children, so you comfort us.
Today we mourn with those who are mourning, and we ask for your comfort.
We grieve mothers who have passed away, and we grieve with mothers whose children have gone before them in death.
We hold space for those who are kept apart for reasons other than death, and we ask you to fill that space with your comfort.
For those in a season of longing today, we remember how you said, "I often long to gather children together as a hen gathers her brood."
Lord, you know this longing. We beg you to meet us in this longing and speak words that satisfy.
For those who have been like mothers to us in so many ways, we remember your words. I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down to them and fed them.
We thank you for the women who have comforted us, fed us, and led us with compassion.
We thank you for mothers who are bending low to children again and again in the thick of those early years.
We celebrate them and ask you to sustain them with rest and endurance.
For women who have been mothers for many years, we are thankful for their faithfulness.
For the example of so many women living out faith in you year after year, we honor them today.
Lord, we are thankful that you are our heavenly mother.
You show us what it means to feed, protect, admonish, and lead one another with the compassion and strength of Mother God.
Today we celebrate women in our midst who reflect your image back to us.
We celebrate you, women of valor.
We are thankful for your leadership and your presence in our community.
And we hope that you are loved well today and every day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
I'm going to invite you today to respond to the message by taking the next step. One of the next steps that you can take is to fill out a digital connection card. To go to sycamorecreekchurch.org/connection and fill out a digital connection card. That connection card helps you to connect with us. It helps us to connect with you. And it's one of the steps that you can take as a response to encountering God today in the message. Next steps that you can take are to join a small group. More about that in a moment. To help with our outdoor cleanup on May 18, or to worship at Fenner Nature Center with all three campuses of Sycamore Creek together on Sunday, May 26. Now, I mentioned joining a small group. We are in a groups and events month here for Sycamore Creek. You can check out the list of small groups and join a small group by going to sycamorecreekchurch.org/small groups. Small groups are the best way to grow in your faith and to connect with God and others. The best way. I'm so happy that you're worshiping online with us, and I hope that online worship is helpful. But if you really want to get to know people and to grow in your faith, there are small groups that are meeting in person. There are small groups that meet online. There are small groups that meet once. There are small groups that meet regularly. All sorts of different small groups. The groups are just a fantastic way to get to know people and to grow in your faith. Go to sycamorecreekchurch.org/small groups. Check out the small groups and sign up for a small group today. We have an outdoor work day coming up on Saturday, May 18 in the morning at our Potterville campus. From 9 to 12, we'll be doing different things like cleaning up debris, weeding our flower beds, putting down fresh mulch, trimming bushes, all sorts of things to make the outside of our church look beautiful and ready for the summer. If you are willing to be a part of that, interested in being a part of that, come and show up. You can just show up. You can bring your own tools if you'd like. We could probably always use more wheelbarrows. Lots of things that will be happening that morning outside of the church. If you'd like to be a part of it, again, that's Saturday, May 18. We'd love to have you there making a difference in our church building and space. As I mentioned, on Memorial Day weekend, Sunday, May 26, we'll be gathered as one church, three different campuses, three different locations, all together in the same place at Fenner Nature Center in Lansing. Same worship time in person of 10:30 a.m. on May 26th. As well, our online worship will be released on May 26th at 9 a.m. at its usual premiere time. So if you want to worship online, you're welcome to that Sunday morning. One other thing that we have coming up is graduation Sunday for our Potterville campus is on June 2. We'll be recognizing and celebrating people who are graduating this year. We'll also be giving kids who are moving from second grade into third grade, a Bible, and we have a whole big group of young people who are doing that at our Potterville campus. You won't want to miss it. That's our graduation Sunday, June 2 at our 10:30 a.m. in-person worship service. I want to thank you for your giving to support the mission of Sycamore Creek. There's so many things that we accomplish through your giving. And not only does giving have an impact outside of you, it impacts you. And I want to encourage you today as a spiritual practice, as a way of growing closer to God, to consider giving. You can go to sycamorecreekchurch.org/give to explore giving to Sycamore Creek. Speaking of your giving, I want to thank you for your giving and all the things that we accomplished. One of the things that we accomplished is this amazing list of small groups that we have. Now, that list of small groups is curated by our small groups director, Tim Newman. Thanks, Tim, for his leadership of the small groups team. And there's a whole small groups team with people from every campus of Sycamore Creek who help coordinate and plan all of these small groups and events that we have throughout the upcoming summer months. Thank you to that group. The list of small groups, I mean, you can see it on the screen there. We're going through all the different small groups. There's so many small groups. Thank you to that team and everyone on that team for their work helping us as a church to ignite authentic life in Christ. We couldn't do all the things that we do, including all the small groups we do, without your generous support that allows us to be a church that worships and has small groups. Here's Kevin with our final worship song. Again, for joining us today for our online worship service. We'll continue next week in our series, God Is. I hope to see you again soon.